All right. Thank you all for joining us here for this fireside chat. We are all here to discuss the very important topic about how to simultaneously integrate sustainability while driving revenue within your organization. So my name is Kurt Harrison. I'm a partner with the global executive search and leadership advisory firm, Russell Reynolds Associates. We have 47 offices in 25 countries around the world, advising our clients around a number of themes regarding human capital and talent, especially across sustainability, ESG, climate, and decarbonization. I'm thrilled to be here today with an amazing panel to discuss this incredible topic, and so I'll introduce them now. Our first panelist is Ben Ratner. Ben is an executive director in sustainability at JPMorgan Chase. Ben leads JPMorgan's external engagement on climate and sustainability issues across the full spectrum of stakeholders, including investors, NGOs, think tanks, and corporations. Prior to JPMorgan, Ben spent 10 years with the Environmental Defense Fund right here in Washington, D.C. So please welcome Ben Ratner. Our next panelist is Viviana Alvarez Sanchez, who has over 15 years of experience across the consumer goods industry. Viviana is the former head of sustainability for Unilever, a company globally acknowledged as a leader in sustainable business. Viviana also served as Unilever's head of corporate strategy in the U.S. and advised the CEO and executive team of Unilever in further integrating sustainability into their overall corporate strategy. Please welcome Viviana Alvarez Sanchez. And our final panelist is Randall Hopkins, very important person. Randall Hopkins is the global head of ESG solutions at NASDAQ. NASDAQ is also a sponsor here of the conference today, as is Russell Reynolds Associates. So we're wonderful to have Randall here. Randall has had a long and illustrious career at NASDAQ, where he has been for the past 22 years in senior leadership roles across their capital markets and corporate platforms. Please welcome Randall Hopkins. All right, so we're on a limited time frame here. We're going to jump right into it. So Ben, in your role at JPMorgan, you are partnering with clients really around the world in helping them to enhance and accelerate their decarbonization energy transition strategies. How have you seen best-in-class sustainability programs transform over the past few years from being more functional programs, compliance-oriented programs, to today being fully integrated business value creation initiatives?
Well, thank you, Kurt. It's great to be with you today, and I can use this. Look, the energy transition is about competition. It's about competing for customers, for capital, for talent, and for a technological edge. And then when you layer in the Inflation Reduction Act, which we've heard a lot about at this summit, that's not so much about creating obligations for companies as it is about creating opportunities, including revenue opportunities. So really, it's no wonder that the businesses that are best positioned to thrive through this transition are the ones, just as you said, who are going well beyond compliance, who are integrating sustainability as a key part of their business strategy and how they create value. So it's not about checking a box for the regulator. It's about thinking outside the box for your customers and for the future of your business. And it's really in that spirit that JPMorgan developed a $1 trillion over 10-year aim for financing and facilitating green initiatives. And we serve.
Trillion with a T.
Trillion with a T. And we serve our clients across sectors, across geographies, as Kurt said, to advise them as they develop their competitive strategies to navigate the low-carbon transition. I thought I would just pull out briefly two complementary, let's say, examples from oil and gas, a sector I do a lot of work on, of companies taking different approaches. So look at Ørsted.
We've had the opportunity to work with Orsted over about 20 years, from green bonds to supporting their initial public offering, and they changed the kind of company that they are. From being years ago about 85% in fossil fuel generation, largely coal, oil, and gas, now with the green energy mix, about 85% of their business and emission reductions on that same order. And on this side of the Atlantic, consider another one, Devon Energy, which is leveraging old capabilities in new ways to compete through the low carbon transition. So Devon, just last month, announced a strategic investment in a startup in the geothermal field. Why does that make sense? Because they are using something they're really good at, which is understanding what's happening beneath the earth and developing resources and branching into a new way to apply that capability of developing heat from the earth. So taking a step back briefly, we are optimistic about the low carbon transition. Green investments, of course, are not immune to changes in capital markets and economic headwinds, but we're optimistic because of the magnitude of the business opportunity for the clients and for the firm.
Yeah, it's a great point. And you really, it illustrates the fact that you can't have a sustainability strategy over here and your business or corporate strategy over here. It's really important that they are one and the same and completely aligned, completely integrated to drive that transformation within the organization as well as externally. So thank you, Ben. That's great. Viviana, you spent over 14 years in a variety of roles at Unilever, eventually being named Head of Sustainability for North America. What are some of the hallmarks of Unilever's approach? I mean, everyone knows Unilever is the gold standard of integrated sustainability, right? So what were some of the hallmarks of Unilever's market-leading approach to sustainability that other companies who might be represented here in the room today, who are perhaps earlier in their journeys, would do well to emulate as they kick off their own sustainability evolution?
So I'll start just connecting the last point on how critical is corporate strategy with sustainability. So I'm one of those classic hybrids that end up in sustainability as a result of an experiment, which was Unilever. In 2008, when the Sustainable Living Plan came out, Paul Polman was just our newly appointed CEO. The first fight he picked up was with Wall Street. He said, look, I don't have time for short term, I'm going to plan long term. You know, of course, the stock market plump. And he said, look, they can't fire me the first 100 days, and I am for real going to, you know, use Unilever as an experiment of medium long-term planning, because what brought us here is not going to take us there. Something needs to change. And you know, fast forward, there was a happy ending with numbers and results that, of course, the cost of inaction or not seeing the big picture, especially in consumer goods, by doing something different will be critical. So, to your question, Kurt, we spoke a lot today about the E and the S. I will do emphasis on governance. And it was first setting the vision, very, very bold, no clue how we were going to get there. And to the markets, the message was, we need help because this is much bigger than ourselves. So the multi-stakeholder model in 2008 was very polemic, because when you put your employees, the livelihoods of, you know, thousands of people that depend on a value chain in consumer goods. We're talking about reaching 3.5 billion consumers every day in 190 countries. So this is not just a consumer goods machine. This is a marketing machine that is reaching every single household. Therefore, the impact that you have is tremendous. So when Paul set the direction, he touched very quickly on governance and really owning this at the top. So top down, there was a clear vision, and he spent a lot of time educating and engaging the shareholders. So there was a lot of nurturing before declaring how we were going to go about it. So it was the top-down vision and allocation of responsibility and capital since the beginning. And the bottom-up, which of course took time, it's a cultural disruption, you know, much like technology, and I tend to compare those two. Sustainability and technology is something that is across the entire value chain and operating model. You either are digital or are not digital. You either are sustainable or you're not sustainable. And I would even argue that the word sustainable is no longer appropriate. It's like, is your marriage sustainable? Sounds horrible, right? So it's the same with sustainability. I think we need to now enter in a much bold conversation about regenerative. And so Unilever very early started challenging us as employees and leaders to think about systems. What is the root cause of the problems we're trying to address, and what could be a systemic solution? So the last point I'd like to make is to make a multi-stakeholder model work, strategic partnerships and co-investments were absolutely critical for the solution and for the commercial and profitability viability of this. And just, during Paul's tenure, 10 years, the TSR was 300%. So even when the markets were accepting about this, there was enough resilience in the P&L to then add much value creation and thinking about the future consumer goods, because the way we are producing and consuming is just no longer sustainable. So, and hopefully throughout the panel, we talk a little bit more about the trade-offs that we need to do as consumers, because we all have the trade-off in order to make this financially and socially and environmentally viable.
You mentioned how important it is to have the leadership from the top, yes. Right? You had a Paul Polman. Now, not every organization has a Paul Polman, but we see this a lot in our business, where we spend a lot of time working with our clients around the world, recruiting heads of ESG or chief sustainability officers. And whenever we approach a senior individual on a big mandate like that, they always ask the same question. Every time, same question. The question always is, how important is this to the board and the CEO of the organization? And if it isn't a fundamental strategic priority for the firm, they're not interested, because they know in the absence of that, they cannot be successful. So it's so important to have the leadership from above, as well as grassroots support. It's an excellent point. Thank you for sharing that. Randall, welcome to the panel, Randall. So Randall joined NASDAQ in 2000, okay? 22 plus years at NASDAQ. Anybody remember what happened in the NASDAQ in 2000? Anybody? Boom, all right, so he joins NASDAQ. It goes down, the index goes down 39% in his first year, 21% in his second year, and 32% in his third year. But Randall turned it around, and here he is today, 22 years later. Give it up for Randall Hopkins. We're all here because of Randall. So, Randall, NASDAQ last week just released its 2023 ESG and Climate Survey. It's an excellent document. It's online. It's available. You can download it. Highly, highly informative. Some amazing data points. One of the headlines of your survey said, in quotes, ESG is more than sustainability. It can also mean profitability, increased valuation, and a true competitive advantage. In your conversations, Randall, with C-suite leaders around the world, board directors, investors, et cetera, how have you seen organizations actually leverage an ESG program to improve both financial and non-financial performance and differentiate their products in the marketplace?
Yeah, thanks for the question and the look back at my career. That was wonderful. I would say that there's a number of different vectors we see prominently. I'd say especially when we think about this quarter, business is tough. You know, companies are trying to maximize their performance, so they're looking at things like, RFP response maximization. How do they make sure their ESG story is leafing in well and telling a comprehensive story to their would-be customers? I'd say the second part is talent retention is a bigger deal now than ever. I'd say, I think most of the statistics quote between, 90% to 200% sort of harm rate on any leaving employee from an expense perspective. So that's the flip side of revenue, but certainly a P&L look that a lot of board members and CEOs will look at. And then the third is, how to maximize the capital markets impact, looking at cost of capital, looking at, the impact of ratings. In a lot of our work, we look at the intersection of a lot of raters and rankers and frameworks and what focal areas they have and the impact that a company can bring to bear on cost of capital, bringing new, $700 billion in passive and $2.9 trillion in active ESG funds, if you can bring that to bear, decrease cost of capital, increase market cap for companies, I think that's really where companies are thinking a lot about how to drive top line and bottom line for their enterprise.
And the two really are interrelated, right? You mentioned the human capital element. You know, it's we're finding it very difficult to recruit best-in-class next-generation leadership to an organization that isn't mission-driven, to an organization that does not subscribe to the three P's of purpose, planet, and profit, right? So it really is important that you really drive that across the organization, again, from the bottom up as well as the top down. So thank you for sharing that. We have an incredible panel up here. Are there any questions? You know, ideally, we want to focus on, again, the business value creation elements of a best-in-class sustainability strategy. I don't know if we have a microphone that we can pass out, but we have a question right here in the back, actually.
I'll defer to the gentleman right here. His hands up. Okay. Thanks.
Hi, thank you so much for the panel. My name is Andrew Fishbein. I'm with Climeworks, a direct air capture company. Thank you very much for your work in this space. I want to especially commend Ben and his colleagues at JP Morgan Chase, actually along with my friend from Charm Industrial, just inked a really landmark $200 million deal for carbon dioxide removal purchase. And what I really would like to ask is getting towards how you think about net zero and how we can align the C-suite and ESG goals towards concrete net zero goals, because I see that there's a gap there that even in the understanding among some CSOs about what net zero really means. So I'd like you to talk about that if you would. Thank you so much.
Look, in the Unilever case, it is when you really embed sustainability into the core of corporate strategy, you have to be very transparent about it, especially with the board and shareholders. And I think a good example on how Unilever culminated that big investment that it was required to retrofit all the assets and really be big and bold and serious about net zero was in 2021, literally in the middle of the pandemic, there was a proxy vote with 99% of the $1 billion that will be required through 10 years to retrofit multi-billion dollar brands. And so first there was transparency about what it was needed and very clear plans, because that's really how you engage all of your multi-stakeholders up in the chain and down in the chain. But I think companies like Unilever have been very vocal as well on the fragility of a lot of these plans and the interdependencies. So this is where technology and rethinking some of the systems is absolutely critical. And where my concern is, and what really keeps me up at night, is that even if we all in aggregate deliver the targets, and we know that there's a big gap into some of those companies that are yet to commit, even in the hypothetical case that we all deliver, it's not enough. And the gap remains too big. And even with all the technologies in place, we know the gap remains very big. So something along the way needs to change. And from the consumer goods industry, where I think the big alarm is, and I'm just trying to be very realistic about it, you have 8 billion souls that need to be fed by 2030. In order to do that, you need to stress the food systems by 50% when we can barely have the capacity right now. And we have been told last year, we were very busy, of course, with the headlines of Russia and Ukraine, but the UN was saying, hey, guys, this is code red. We are now producing more that we can actually, we're consuming more that we can produce. So where a lot of the value is going to come from is from waste, from all the waste packaging, from all the food waste, and from all the things that we need to recover and put back in the economy. So unless we start thinking in a much more disruptive way and doing a scenario planning, that now with AI is fantastic because this is happening really fast. So we have a lot of insights that we didn't have before. Numbers are on our side. So it's much easier to change hats and speak with, shareholders or But it's going to be required a bolder thought on how to go about this if we want the numbers to work.
Yeah, I think it's a great question because, you know, net zero, we saw a lot of CEOs 2021 making net zero commitments, and we've had those same CEOs come to our organization and say, okay, I've made this commitment, how am I going to actually do this? So you have to recruit a lot of new people. And if you're subscribing to science-based target initiatives, which I know is the topic of the next conversation, which I hope you'll stick around for, it's a whole different level of scrutiny and rigor that needs to be applied. So it's a great question. I think there was a question up front here. Yes, we have one. In the back, sorry. Go ahead.
I'm Harris with Charm Industrial. I have seen in CDP reports a lot of talk about climate reputational benefit trying to be quantified, saying things like 100 basis points of market cap or 1% of revenue could potentially swing based on a company's climate reputation benefit. And so a question to the panelists would be, if you have some examples, and you don't have to say exactly who they are, or you could make it a little spicier, of companies that have actually like seen this in practice, like put that in the CDP report and then actually reported back on it to their investors or board or what have you by actually quantifying their climate reputation benefit.
Yeah, it's a really important question, and it actually I'll answer it two ways. One is, you know, I think it, when you look at the quantitative measures, we look at 10,000 corporates that we're working with. It really does depend a lot on industry and sector, and how the investor behavior will react, and how the valuations get set, both on a short-term, medium, and long-term basis. So I'd say there's no one answer. But I would say it does highlight a key point of emphasis, I think, to make around research. And we heard it in the debate this morning. I think the industry is beginning to do a lot more work around, you know, what counts for quantifiable content around, you know, cause and effect, around, you know, any kind of stochastic measures in the business. And I think that as we think about next year, and the years past, I think that's going to be an area of extreme focus from both financial markets as well as from the academy in the finance departments. And I think getting the answer, or even if it's a range of answers, is really going to help derive a lot of corporate behavior.
It's a great way to end it. So we're out of time, but if you have any questions for the panelists, we'll be in the back of the room or outside afterwards. Thank you for joining us. Hope it was entertaining and informative, and I'll turn it back over to Vijay. Thank you.